One of the funnest things you discover once you've got your feet firmly planted into the guitar world are effects pedals. Whether it was seeing Graham Coxon aggressively step on a little black box in the Song 2 video, that's a reference for all my 90s kids out there, or it's seeing your favourite guitarist surrounded by what looks like more of an airplane cockpit than like a guitar setup with all the knobs and buttons that are flashing. I'm sure we've all had a moment of intrigue when it comes to these little boxes of wonder. But where do you start with so many effects pedals to choose from? It can be quite an intimidating sort of part of the guitar, you know, learning experience and journey, just knowing where to start. Also to know exactly what you might need when it comes to obviously effects pedals. So that's why I'm gonna explain to you today how to, you know, find the right effects pedals for you, what the effects pedals are, how to build a board, and some of the things you might need if you are planning on doing that. Cool? Cool. Well, grab yourself a water and grab a snack because we're gonna get into this. And if you do want to do a little bit of reading as well, we do have a blog on our website where obviously we go into the same amount of detail with some sort of photos and diagrams and whatnot if you do prefer that. The link will just be below. So I'm gonna call this section the essentials, but just to preface this, there really isn't a sort of necessity for pedals, just to sort of clear that up. There are loads of guitarists out there who plug directly into their amp with their guitar and have an absolute blast with it and get all they need just from that. But for those looking to get into pedals, they can be broken down to a few categories, which I'll briefly explain just now. Drives, dynamics, modulation, reverb, delay, EQ, filter slash wah, and then there's a few specifics like loopers and some other things, and I will touch on them very briefly later on in the video. Now that is quite a general categorization of them, and probably at this point, if you've not experienced any pedals, it's not going to make a lot of sense to you. Putting them into those categories, it can certainly kind of help you understand what certain pedals do and, you know, kind of to tailor your tastes towards certain pedals as well. So probably the most common type of pedal that you will see, or a lot of people's first ones, are going to be drives and distortions. They perform a very obvious function by distorting your guitar signal and overall shaping your tone, and they are quite interchangeable, and they're also like they're quite fluid as well across. You can either go for something that's, you know, quite a subtle sort of boost or just a shaping sort of tool, or you can go for something that's a much more obvious like this fuzz, which, you know, will absolutely rumble the floor when you stick it on. Dynamics are a slightly more nuanced and maybe a little bit more subtle form of effect, and they usually come in the form of a compressor or a noise gate. Now if you are starting out, this probably is one that you're not really going to have to worry about, especially, you know, if you are just building your first board. These are really important when it comes to guitar tone, but again, starting out, I would focus on something that's maybe a bit more sort of obvious and a bit more apparent and also just a little bit more fun. Now, to put it in the most simple terms possible, essentially what a compressor does is it will make all of your notes very similar volume levels. It'll make your quiet notes louder, it'll make your louder notes quiet, keeping it all within the same sort of dynamic range. That's where, you know, the term dynamics comes from when it comes to these kinds of pedals. Again, not something you really need to focus on immediately. They are very important when it comes to guitar, but again, just if you're getting started out, go with something maybe like a drive or a delay or something like that. When it comes to a noise gate as well, what they will do is they'll just kind of overall reduce some of the feedback and maybe some unwanted noises you want. Or if you particularly listen to metal, that's an effect that is used a lot with that. But again, much like a compressor, maybe not something you need to worry about until later down the line. Modulation is a bit of a blanket term for a few effects. Things like chorus, phaser, flanger, a tremolo, they'll all fall under this category. One of the most obvious things about them is that they will make such an obvious kind of shift to your tone when they're on. Think of a song like Message in a Bottle from The Police. There is a flanger on pretty much all the guitar through that, and Andy Summers, he used it throughout all of The Police's career. Flanger are kind of producing this whirling and whooshing sort of sound again that's very, very obvious when it's on, much like something like a tremolo, where if you can associate that with the Smiths song How Soon Is Now, and what that does is it brings your guitar's volume in and out in this sort of pulsing fashion. It's quite rhythmic, it's again very obvious when it is on, and it can be quite specific to, you know, certain people's tastes as well. So reverb and delay, they can kind of be lumped into very similar categories in terms of time-based effects. Now, the most simple way to sort of explain reverb is imagine yourself in a big hall, you shout out, and you can hear just like this big sort of echo in space happening before eventually your voice diffuses after it's out. That's pretty much what a reverb does, to the lowest extent all the way to the most extreme, where you can sound like you're in a small room, all the way to this absolute gargantuan cave if you want to. Delay has a similar effect in terms of adding space to your notes, but it is a lot more obvious. Some people call it an echo. That's quite a sort of good way to think about it as well. Someone like The Edge from U2 uses delay in a lot of his parts, so you'll be quite familiar. It is just that sort of repeating. You'll say one thing, one thing, one thing, one thing, one thing, and then it'll come back to you. Now, to touch on EQ pedals as well, they are quite an obvious function that they basically will affect your guitar's tone and your amp's tone without you actually having to touch either one of them. You can also get into much more sort of in-depth levels of frequencies and tones. Think of it as an expanded version of the bass, middle and treble that you'll see on a standard guitar amp. They're also very specific sort of uses as well, so much like compressors or the noise gates, it's not really something that you need to worry about initially unless there is something, you know, really specific that you are searching for. Now, much like modulations, if we're talking about filters and wahs, which is our last category that we'll touch on, they add a very, very obvious effect to your guitar signal. Filters maybe aren't something that you really need to focus on. There's things like ring modulators and some, you know, other kind of synthesizer-ish effects, which, much like some of the other ones we've touched on, aren't essential when you start. But if we are talking about wahs, they are very, very popular amongst a lot of guitarists when they're starting to get into effects pedals. What they're doing is essentially an EQ sweep where it'll make your sort of higher frequencies a lot more apparent, and then when you roll back on it, it'll make the lower frequencies a lot more apparent. But to put it in the most simple terms, and something that you probably heard, there's a kind of classic chaka-chaka sound that'll come from it. Guitarists like Tom Morello, Jimi Hendrix, the Shaft theme song, no doubt everybody's heard that at least once, and again, very, very obvious when it is on. So now that we've covered kind of loosely what the categories are, because again, this kind of can expand and go quite crazy in terms of different kinds of effects you've got, but that's a really good place to start. But on that note of where to start, what's the best pedal to start with? This, of course, is very, very subjective per player. So say, for example, you are into more kind of classic rock from the 80s or the 90s, you're probably going to want to start with something like a drive pedal or a fuzz pedal. A wah-wah is a great one for that, because you'll be able to just emulate some of those tones that, you know, some of the songs that you like or some of your heroes are getting. Whereas if you're more into kind of more ambient guitar, or you're into more sort of like soundscape sort of things, or, you know, some modern bands as well, something like a reverb or a delay will immediately be sort of gratifying to you, and you'll immediately start getting these sounds that you've been craving. If you were to ask me, my first suggestion would be to any guitarist, now it is a pedal that we haven't actually spoke about, it's the tuner. Now, this might not be the most fun pedal to start with, because obviously it doesn't really produce a sound. If anything, when you turn it on, it actually cuts your sound out and allows you to tune your guitar using the screen. But come on, what's more fun than having your guitar in tune? As much as our YouTube comments love to remind me of that on some videos. Wah, wah, wah. Kidding on, you guys are the best. But anyway, what a tuner does, as I said, it will cut your signal off, the screen will light up, and you'll be able to see what your actual tuning is. So it comes in clutch when you're playing live, or even just without you having to, you know, turn your clip-on tuner or turn your volume down or anything. It's a really, really handy pedal, and specifically a lot of them are kind of built like tanks as well, so they'll last you for ages. But anyway, if I was to recommend an actual, you know, obvious guitar pedal, I would say something maybe like a drive or a delay would get you off to a really good start. They're sort of a good jumping off point for you to start sort of wading your way through the waters of pedals, because not only will they be really obvious when you turn them on and you can start to get those sounds that you've been really wanting to get, but they can also kind of add a bit of sort of inspiration to your playing as well. Now, I'm not saying that buying a pedal is the way to write a song. I can certainly speak for myself, and certainly a lot of us at Guitar as well, that when we get a new pedal or anything new, it can just help to drive that inspiration and just, you know, make you want to play your guitar as well. But it will more than likely be quite a developing taste as you go on as well. So something like, you know, a pretty, you know, sort of versatile drive. You'll be able to use that through lots of situations, or something like a delay is always going to be a delay. You know, there is different categories even when it comes into that. That's again later down the line for when you start to develop those tastes. Now, building a board and collecting pedals will no doubt be for a lot of guitarists a huge part of their playing, but if you've made it to this point in the video and you are feeling a little bit overwhelmed, especially if this is your first sort of foray into effects pedals, I totally understand as well, because I was absolutely in your position. And funnily enough, the board that you're seeing here, about 95% of this is actually my pedals, and I've built these up over the years just of kind of developing tastes and just to fit what I want. If you want something that's a bit more condensed and a little less separate, funnily enough, there are pedals that do multiple effects, and funnily enough, they are called multi-effects pedals. Now, don't worry though, this isn't the only, I forgot how heavy that was, that isn't the only size that you get in multi-effects when it comes to some other pedals that will do pretty much every single sound you can get. Some of them will actually be exactly the same size as some of the pedals on this board here. We did just do a video on such a product called the HX1 that you can watch above my head or in the description there. But that'll basically just give you the opportunity to try a lot of sounds. It's one of the things that I kind of enjoyed when I was sort of growing up playing guitar, was I got a multi-effects pedal. It allowed me to sort of try, well, this is the sound of a phaser, this is the sound of a flanger, okay, what kind of drive is this? It just allows you to just experiment without having to properly dive into the deep end of buying something and then maybe you're regretting it later down the line. So we went through all of the different kinds of categories and, you know, which pedals might be right for you. But one of the most frequent questions that we get in the shop is actually, what order should I put my pedals in? What is the way to actually build a board? And I kind of want to touch on that a little bit in this section. Before we jump into the actual specific order, there are a couple of extra bits that I do want to touch on that aren't pedals, but will really, really help you if you do plan on building a board similar to this, or even smaller or even bigger if you want to go crazy like that. These will really, really benefit you down the line. So one of the most important things that I think will really, really benefit you down the line is actually investing yourself in a power supply for your pedalboard. Now, these vary from relatively cheap to really, really expensive as well. The sort of easy way to sort of distinguish that is the more expensive ones will be able to power a lot more pedals, they'll be a bit more reliable, whereas something cheaper, you know, will still work pretty well. But at one point you may have to replace it, especially if you start stacking lots of pedals together. Most pedals will run off of a 9-volt battery when you get them, something like the Boss pedals. They all have them in them there. But if you've got a bunch of pedals like this on a board and you need to kind of consistently be replacing 9-volt batteries, number one, during a gig, that's one of the most stressful situations you can be in. And number two, it can, you know, get quite expensive pretty quickly. So having a sort of consistent form of power that you can just plug into the wall and then connect up your pedals just with the cables is going to save you in the long run. Also, investing in something like a pedal board as well just gives you somewhere to always have your pedals set up, always ready to be played. They usually come with cases or carry bags as well, so you can just roll up to a gig or a practice or a friend's house, pull your pedal board out, and that's you ready to go after you've connected it. Now, you don't need to buy one like this. I've seen a lot of people who have built their own, just as long as you've got somewhere dedicated to be able to set your pedals up with. And also, having some Velcro on them as well just means that your pedals are always going to be in the one place, and it also means you can move them about when you need to as well. The more pedals you get, the more cables you are going to need to connect them up as well. So you're probably going to want to invest in a few patch cables. Now, what these are just guitar cables, but very, very short. You're not going to want to connect up a bunch of pedals with full length 10 meter guitar cables. Like I said, they just clip just in as normally, and you can just hook up all your pedals like that. Now, with a board as well like this, you can get into real cable management sort of dorkiness if you want to, which I'm a big fan of. I haven't hooked these pedals up just for this video so I can kind of move them about, but the good thing about made pedal boards is that you can wire a lot of pedals underneath, keep something really clean on top, and it just means you don't need to worry about like tripping over a cable or something when you're trying to hit your drive pedal. So getting into the actual order of pedals, I'm going to grab my prop here of a big bit of paper on a guitar stand box because I forgot my whiteboard today, but I want to make it nice and clear for you. But Much like the essentials section of this video, there isn't really a set way of ordering your pedals. Now, there is a traditional way, and there is a way that will sort of universally known as the best way to connect your pedals, but there is a lot of fun in experimenting with the order of them, because you might actually find that you'll get some sounds that you maybe weren't expecting or suit you perfectly. So do take this with a slight pinch of salt. This is a great place to start, but if there's something maybe not suited to yourself, then feel free to experiment as well. Now, the way that I'm going to be demonstrating this is essentially taking all of your pedals here, connecting them all up together and just plugging them directly into the front of your amp. Now, there is a function on a lot of modern amps called the effects loop, and this is something that we're not going to touch on today. A little bit more specific, it requires some different cabling. So for this, essentially what you're doing is just connecting all your pedals together, then taking your guitar cable, going into your pedal board, guitar cable coming out, that's then going to go into your amp. But I'll draw a diagram just so that you can kind of see it really, really clearly, as well as the pedal board beside me. So I'm going to explain this in a very linear fashion. So essentially, like I said, starting with the guitar going through the pedal board, going out of your board into the amp. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the order that the pedals are cabled in is represented linearly on the pedal board. And I'll explain that when I get to kind of right to the end here. So starting things off, we're going to have our guitar. I'm going to cable out into that. First things first, do excuse my handwriting, you're just going to need to deal with that. We're going to go into the tuner, which is just here. So if you imagine, the guitar cable is just going right into there. What I would then suggest that we go into is the wah-wah right after, just there. So what you'll do is you'll take a patch cable, you put it into there, that'll come out. We're then, and this is a type of effect that we didn't really touch on that much in the video, but we're going into pitch now. That's the micropog here. That's going to kind of alter your sound a little bit. You know, it's, you're going to sound like a bass guitar or maybe something a little bit higher as well. Very, very specific, but that's where I would then put that. What we're then going to go into is all of your distortions or overdrives next. So that'll be these two here. Now again, the order in these will give you slightly different results. The way that I've got this board set up is that the lower gained pedal is going to go into the higher gain pedal, which that's the Earthquaker Plumes, which is a kind of tube screamery sort of voice pedal, going into the Triangle Big Muff, which is, you know, very, very obvious when it's on. But what you're doing is you're essentially kicking the gain into the Big Muff there to alter that and maybe get an extra kick. If you did those the other way around, you would be putting the Big Muff into the Tube Screamer, and basically the Tube Screamer's EQ would change the sound of this, obviously, if they were reversed around. Give it a try, it might be, you know, exactly what you're looking for. So the next one that I would do, certainly, and demonstrating it on the pedal boards here, is we are going to go into our modulations. Now, the way that you might think this board has been set up is that we go into the tuner, into the wah-wah, into the pog, into the overdrive section here, and then this cable is going to go up to here. This is actually going to be my end point for the pedal board. So you can get yourself slightly longer patch cable, something like this. Much longer, obviously, if you're going to want to go to there. But what I would do is I would take a cable out, do it onto the board, and then go into the top of the pedal, kind of like that. So we're then going to go into the modulation section just right after there. And again, I've got this sort of set up that there's multiple modulations on. There's no limit to each type of pedal that you want. So if you do want a board just full of modulation effects or a board full of distortion pedals, you go for it. Then kind of taking up the last few sections, as I mentioned, I would then go into delays after that. I would then go into reverbs right after that too. To which then we'd come out, and this little tiny section up in the corner here is where the amp will go. Having those two at the end, essentially the way to sort of see that is that you're going to want to sort of shape your sound before you get to the effects that are just going to like add space and add repeats to your sound. If you're doing these beforehand, you're basically going to then manipulate the sound of the repeats and the delays and, you know, the kind of space that you're adding with the reverb. So traditionally, you would be putting these time-based effects right at the end. Now again, this is very crude, obviously, the way I've done it. It shows you I'm much more of a guitarist than I am an artist. This is quite a sort of, you know, easy way to sort of represent what's going on here. This can kind of be a bit confusing looking at it again, especially because we're going in here, we're then doubling back on ourselves and going up to the top there. And that's not to say that your pedal board needs to be, you know, exactly this sort of configuration. If you do want to have it just in a big line all going, that's cool. If you want to, you know, have kind of cables kind of going diagonally, do what you need to do to make it work for you. The main thing for pedal boards is obviously to get your sound and to be able to shape your tone just at your feet while you're playing. It's also, you know, to set it up the way that you need it so that in a pinch and a gig, you know exactly where everything is. And ideally the state you want to get to is that you know where everything is right under your feet, so you don't even need to look at it. I did briefly touch on loopers earlier as well, in the sense that I just mentioned them, but this is more just a little tip if you are planning on building a board with a looper in it, or, you know, if you're practicing in the house and you want to use a looper to have some sort of tracks playing. I would always recommend to put the looper right at the end of the chain. So just before you hit the amp, you're going to come at your last pedal into a looper into your amplifier, because if you think about it, if you put a looper anywhere else in the chain, especially at the start, you're going to put a loop into that pedal, it's then going to come out and it's then going to be manipulated by every single pedal that it goes through. So the sound that you put into it isn't necessarily the sound that's going to come out. Whereas if it's right at the end of the chain, any pedal that you've activated, it's going to go into the looper, the sound's going to come out, and it's not going to be manipulated by anything after. So that about covers it when it, you know, comes to building a pedal board and maybe some of the categories and some of the pedals that you should be looking at. As I've mentioned, this is more of a sort of starting guide. This isn't necessarily rules to live by. This isn't, you know, anything that you shouldn't be experimenting with. One of the funnest things in guitar playing, as I sort of kicked off the video with, is getting into the world of pedals and really starting to sort of express yourself via different sounds. As, you know, as I've mentioned, and you can take a drink for every time I said as I mentioned in this video, as I mentioned, it's a great sort of spot for inspiration. It's really good, you know, self-expression, and that's what guitar is all about, is finding your voice within this, you know, many years of different players out there. And certainly I've sort of tailored my pedal style to a lot of players at first, whether it be what they're using, whether it be what I've seen on their boards. But eventually I start to sort of carve out my own sound and start to carve out my own path through that. And again, still very inspired by a lot of people, but I found what I like, and I like what I like. So you should find what you like, and you like what you like. But hopefully that's made things clearer. By all means, with a video like this, we do want people to send in their questions. We do want people to get involved with it. So if you do have any sort of further points you want us to touch on, please leave them down in the comments there. We'll be happy to look at them and answer any of your questions. And hey, while you're there, give us a subscribe and give us a like. It will really, really help the channel, and I do appreciate it. But until then, I've been Keiran, and this has been my sort of easy guides, maybe a bit complicated guides on how to build a pedal board. Have a great day.